In this next graphic from the AR5, we see global averages and three graphs communicating that information. The first graph is about land surface temperatures. The second one is about land and ocean surface temperatures. The third one is about ocean heat content. Beneath the three graphs, we have a key. And the black lines are the observations that we have physically collected. This is real data. And the blue areas are computer models that look only at natural forcings, that is, natural heating events that could explain temperatures. And then the pink parts of these graphics illustrate models that use both natural as well as anthropogenic heating components, that is, explaining heating using natural forces as well as man-made forces. So on the first graphic on the left, we see land surface, and we see then that we've got models that use only natural forcings being responsible for having approximately zero degrees of temperature difference. And there's some fluctuation there, and there's some error that's likely. That's why the line is kind of thick instead of narrow like the black one. So computer models that model temperature of the Earth have looked at natural forcings only and say, well, if we exclude the human element and just look at natural forcings, we would expect approximately 0 degrees temperature difference. When you add the human element, the anthropogenic element, we see that that's the pink part of this graph, and we see that there is, after 1960, a relatively steep climb in the expected temperature of the land surfaces. Now, computer models model that. That is, they spit that information out. Once we see that information, we can then check the computer models and see if they are in fact correct or incorrect. And we then thus lay the observation line, the black line, over the blue as well as the pink areas and see, well, the black observed line only matches the pink area. And this means then that the computer model has accurately predicted that the observed temperature change is due not just to natural forcings, but due to natural and anthropogenic forcings. That is, natural and human-induced heating that we observe. The same can go for the land and ocean temperatures, as well as the ocean heat content. In every one of these cases, we see that without humans as a variable, there is very little expected change in temperature. Once you introduce the human element, then temperature increases. And that is backed up with actual real data that's been observed across land and across surfaces of ocean areas. In the next slide, we have Northern Hemisphere September sea ice extent. And we have on the y-axis millions of square kilometers. And we see that from 1950 to 2000, we have approximately, say, 7 or so million square kilometers of Northern Hemisphere September sea ice extent. And that begins to drop off a little bit as the late 20th century gets rolling. And so we see that by the year 2005, 2010, in that area, we've already experienced some significant change in the extent of our September Northern Hemisphere sea ice extent. Whereas it used to be hovering around, say, 7 million square kilometers, now it's dropped below 6 million square kilometers. And again, the dark purplish, bluish area that's on that part of the map is the expected probability or the error that could be in these studies, and the black lines and the dashed lines are actual data that's been collected. As we go beyond the current time and look at projections or various scenarios, we have various lines. We have got red lines and blue lines, and then various areas, red and or rather pink and blue areas. And all of these then indicate that that there's going to be an increasingly smaller and smaller Northern Hemisphere September sea ice extent as the 21st century matures. Various models are predicting this. So we see then that we have a significant change coming up with our September sea ice extent. And we have to then ask ourselves, are we ready for this? And if so, and if not, well, what are we doing about this? But the consensus then of the scientific community around the world is that not only has September sea ice extent in the Northern Hemisphere decreased, and that's an observable event, but the scientific consensus says that it's going to continue to decrease as the 21st century matures. Finally, we have the third graph here, and this is about the global ocean surface pH. Okay, so this graph looks only at the ocean surfaces and looks at the pH of the ocean water. The pH scale measures whether a solution is alkaline or acid. Pure water is 7, and the scale goes from 0 to 14. So we see then that on the y-axis, we have from 1950 to shortly after the turn of the century, global ocean surface pH around, say, 8.15, which is slightly alkaline. As then the 21st century matures, we see two scenarios. The blue scenario, the top line, has the scenario where carbon dioxide levels are stabilized at a set rate, and then the ocean acidification starts to also stabilize. This is a scenario. The red line beneath that shows another scenario where carbon dioxide emissions increase through the 21st century, and that then leads to an increasingly acidified surface ocean. And we see then that in this scenario, by 2100, we have a ocean surface pH it looks like well below 7.8 on the pH scale. Now, this is important. We don't think about ocean water being acidic or alkaline usually, but it's a critical factor because phytoplankton, which is the plant and animal life that float on the surface of the water, they form the basis of the food chain, and they have a particular level of alkalinity and acid in terms of the solution that they can live in. Once water becomes too acidic or too alkaline, they die. And that's the base of the food chain, and everything else then has a ripple effect because the base is removed. So scientists and governments are, of course, concerned about this, because if our ocean becomes more acidic, then we have to be prepared for the repercussions. But these two scenarios then are illustrated here, and again, this is the scientific consensus of climate scientists and also oceanographers as they look at the current pH level of our ocean surfaces and projected pH levels of our ocean surfaces.